When your chemistry teacher taught you about the octet rule, they were not expecting this compound. Undressing a carbon to just 4 valence electrons looks impossible. Genius combination of energetic stabilization and steric shielding allowed chemists to recently isolate this novel doubly oxidized carbene. Keep watching to learn about its synthesis and reactivity. Don't be fooled thinking it will be intuitive. We're going to see some crazy reactions, exotic orbitals, and super Lewis acids. The octet rule is a broad guideline that states atoms strive to bond towards closed shell configurations. This is most applicable to non-metal ions and elements like carbon or nitrogen. You will all know some exceptions to the rule as well. Elements below the third period can be hypervalent. On the other hand, carbon violates the octet rule when forming carbenes. This makes them highly reactive and is why compounds like N-heterocyclic carbenes have found many applications in synthetic chemistry. To get to our desired dication, we need to take a carbene and do the opposite of what it wants. Remove 2 additional electrons, making its octet even more incomplete. Let's dive into the synthesis, which requires linkage of 2 identical building blocks. This starting material comes from bromination of the stabilized carbene, introducing a bromide handle for the linker. By adding formamidine and base, we get an intermediary cationic dimer through nucleophilic attack and elimination of bromide. After an anion switch to the triflet, strong base can deprotonate the central carbon, giving the carbene. This compound has several insightful features. It's stable at minus 78 degrees, but above minus 20 was found to rearrange. Never forget the groups behind abbreviations on paper, because it's actually the aryl ring which undergoes a de-aromative 3+2 cycle addition with the carbene system. This is pretty unusual because the aromatic ring is boring and not activated. The carbene is so nucleophilic that it doesn't care, leading to the highly sterically congested adduct. It not only looks hilarious, but it's really more interesting than you would think. The energy difference between the masked and the free carbene is not that high, indicating potential reversibility. Indeed, reaction with a gold complex led to quantitative conversion to the carbene adduct. The masked carbene is not shut off. There is a dynamic equilibrium between both species. Get this, the masked carbene was surprisingly stable to air and moisture even at 1 month of storage. Even under non-inert conditions, the masked carbene proved its worth. Reaction with carbon dioxide in presence of air and moisture again quantitatively afforded the CO2 adduct. The carbene engages in more exotic sigma and pi bond activations like addition to nitriles, which are usually the opposite of electron deficient. But to this insanely nucleophilic species, everything is an electrophile. By the way, if you think the topic is cool, let me know with a comment or a like. Thanks to all my awesome channel members and also for you for watching this video. To get to carbon 2+, we clearly require oxidation to reduce the number of valence electrons. Past research, primarily on N-heterocyclic carbenes, showed that single electron oxidation of carbenes leads to short-lived reactive intermediates. Successive double oxidation to the dication had never been observed, but rather, only conjugate acids of the carbenes were formed through hydrogen abstraction of solvent molecules. The research at hand showed that a 2-electron oxidation worked quite easily by adding iodine once they formed the nucleophilic carbene. However, undressing the carbon by elimination of iodide did not work at all. This might be because the carbon has a particularly high affinity to halogens. They took a detour by adding sodium trimethyl siloxide, essentially an oxide dianion synthone. This swaps out the iodide, leading to a neutral carbonyl compound all in one pot. Fortunately, removing this new oxide group was much more achievable. The procedure was surprisingly simple, using 3 equivalents of triflic anhydride. This activates and abstracts the oxide on the central carbon. A complex of the dication plus 2 coordinating triflate anions simply precipitates as a white solid. With 90% yield and 800 mg scale, this detour was super successful. But why can this molecule even exist? First, we clearly have electronic stabilization from the N-heterocyclic imine. For instance, the positive charge can move from the central carbon to the C2 carbon sitting between the nitrogens. between these two extremes, there's also a cumulenic structure where we have four successive double bonds. The author suggests that this form best resembles the real structure, which makes sense given it lies between the two extreme resonances. There's also asymmetric delocalization with the terminal nitrogen that would give this resonance structure with a central triple bond. Remember this for when we talk about the structure in a moment. The space-filling model clearly illustrates the large steric profile of the diisopropyl phenyl groups. This shields the dication even from coordination of the triflate anions, which are located further away in an outer sphere. The system adopts a zigzag structure. The central carbon is almost linear with a bond angle of 163 degrees. The C1N1 distance is significantly shorter than C2N1, suggesting a higher degree of multiple bonding, which we can rationalize through the resonance structure featuring the triple bond. Both amino rings lean to the same side, but they are actually just short of orthogonal with an 80 degree torsion angle. This is exactly what we would expect from an even-numbered cumulene. Our system is basically a nitrogen analog of a dicationic 4-cumulene. By the way, if you got confused, the even number relates to the number of pi bonds, not the number of atoms in the pi system. We also see the cumulenic delocalization in the structure of the LUMOs, corresponding to the empty p-type orbitals on the central C1. The frontier orbitals twist into helical Möbius shapes, which is again characteristic for even cumulenes. As a comparison, you can see that odd-numbered cumulenes would have orbitals that lie in plane and are not helical. Enough with structure. How does it behave? With two vacant sites, it will obviously be a Lewis acid. Adding dimethylaminopyridine gives the Lewis-based stabilized dication complex, confirming that the central carbon is indeed the dominant electrophile of the cumulenic system. The triflate anions want to get some action as well, but again, their coordination is more distant. How strong is this Lewis acidity? We can quantify it by computing affinities to fluoride as a hard anion and to hydride as a soft anion. You can see that the hydride affinity is higher, reflecting the softer nature of the central carbon. But are these numbers high or low? Well, the dication is significantly more acidic than the tritylcation, the archetypical carbon Lewis acid. However, it's not on the same level as other super-duper Lewis acids, like this dicationic phosphorus. The cumulenic stabilization suppresses the affinity enough to make the compound isolable, but it retains significant reactivity. As a strong electrophile, the dication will readily abstract anions from various groups, including alkanes. Throwing a hydride and a Grignard reagent at it appends both substituents on the central carbon, confirming that there are two accessible coordination sites. If you wonder what this compound is tangibly useful for, not even the authors know. But clearly, such fundamental breakthroughs will advance our understanding of various aspects of chemistry. If you liked this video, please subscribe and check out my channel. Thanks for watching, and as always, until next time.